गुड मॉर्निंग सर स्टूडेंट्स, द नेक्स्ट सब टॉपिक इन मेडिकल सोशियोलॉजी 2 इज एपिडेमियोलॉजी. ओके, दिस इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक. इट इज़ नॉट ओनली फॉर द थर्ड ईयर्स बट ऑल्सो फॉर द सेकेंड ईयर्स एंड फॉर ऑल पीपल, यू नो, फॉर ऑल प्रोफेशंस. दिस इज़ अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक फॉर एनी हेल्थ केयर वर्कर एंड एस्पेशली फॉर योर मेडिकल सोशियोलॉजिस्ट. This can be a separate career path. You know, if you can become an epidemiologist after you finish your medical sociology. That means you will be in the field of epidemiology. So let us see what is epidemiology and how the epidemiology is developed. Okay. So epidemiology is the study of determinants, distribution and frequency of disease. So in short, it says epidemiology is who gets disease and why they get disease. Okay, so now I hope you would have understood the seriousness and the importance of this topic. In the situation of a pandemic of coronavirus affecting the whole world, if you can tell the public who will get coronavirus and why they get coronavirus, okay, just imagine how people would be happy for you. And how they would be grateful when you can tell who is getting coronavirus and why they are getting coronavirus. Okay, if you know who is getting coronavirus, then you can prevent those people from going into the public. They can stay at home and be safe. If you know why they are getting coronavirus, you can prevent the disease. So epidemiology is the study of determinants, means what all causes a particular disease. Distribution, that is who all has that disease, where they live, why, which place gets more disease, which place has less disease, and frequency of disease, who is having very severe, where it spreads more, where it spreads less. You know, in Italy we know that many people died because of coronavirus. In India the death rate is much lesser. So what is the difference? That is the role of epidemiologists. So epidemiologists study why the people in, they study the characteristics of people who died in Italy. And then they have found that older people, people with more comorbidities, they are the people who died in Italy. In India, more people are able to live. So if you do epidemiology, you will know who gets a particular disease and why they get the disease. This is not just applicable for coronavirus, but it's applicable for all diseases. Whether it's a bacterial disease, viral disease, even if it's a non-communicable disease like cancer or stroke, so, and cardiac problems. So for every disease, there is epidemiology. Who gets the disease, why they get the disease, and the determinants, that the comorbidities or other factors that cause the disease, the distribution of the disease and the frequency of the disease. So that is epidemiology. Okay, so epidemiologists study sick people and they also study healthy people. Just because a person is sick, the epidemiologists do not study only them. Even healthy people, they study and say why they are healthy, why they do not get disease. Okay, if you study those people, then it's easy for other sick people also to have the same lifestyle of the healthy people, so that the sick people also become healthy. Okay, so epidemiology is the basis of all healthcare, and medical sociology is very much related to epidemiology because you also are involved in a lot of epidemiological work. Okay, so epidemiologists study exposed people and epidemiologists also study non-exposed people. For example, suppose a person gets cancer. So we see who are those who are getting cancer. Are they exposed to a particular hazard? Have they been involved in in smoking, or have they been involved in eating burnt food items because they get colon cancer? So any person who gets a particular disease, we go back and check in their life if they have been exposed to a cause which has caused the disease. So that is again another role of epidemiology. So epidemiology, the word came because of three different words. Epi means upon, demos means people, and ology means science. So epidemiology is the science of that deals with what falls upon people, like what diseases fall upon people. So that is epidemiology. And epidemiology can be said to be the bridge between biomedical, social and behavioral science. Okay, so we have seen biomedical theory of health and social theory of health. So this is the bridge that connects all the diseases, like biomedical disease, social disease, behavioral disease. So epidemiology connects everything. So let us see the uses of epidemiology. The epidemiology helps in determining and describing or reporting on the natural cause of disease, disability, death and injury, whether it is accident or whether it is a plane crash or whether it is train accident or a bomb blast or a disability which was caused because of leprosy or a disease like coronavirus or cancer or HIV, everything. So epidemiology determines the cause of the disease, it describes the disease and reports on how the disease progresses. Okay, and then it also helps in planning and development of health services and programs. You know, the government of India has blindness control program, national leprosy eradication program. So all these are programs and health services. So based on the epidemiology, we know. So now for coronavirus, again we'll come to that example. People say asymptomatic people, even if they test positive for coronavirus, you do not need to go to the hospital. Only symptomatic people need to go to the hospital. How did they come to that conclusion? Because of epidemiologists, they have studied the disease and they have planned and developed a health program where only affected people who are symptomatic will need treatment. Okay, so epidemiology also provides administrative data and planning data. Epidemiology studies the cause. Etiology means cause of the disease or conditions which occur because of the disease, disorders and disabilities that result from the disease, or disorders and disabilities that lead to some other problem. All this the epidemiologists will study. Then they determine the primary agent responsible for a particular disease or the causative factor. Okay, and what is the reason for a person getting a disease? So they look at that. Then they look at the mode of transmission, how the disease spreads from one person to another. This is studied by epidemiology. Okay, and it determines the contributing factors. What are the factors that affect the spread, affect the what cause the disease? So in second year you would have studied determinants of health, the age of the person, the sex of the person, the ethnicity of the person. So epidemiology is based on all these factors. For example, one particular race may be more at risk of getting cardiac problems. Like there is a general perception that Asian people, especially Indians, are more at higher risk for cardiac problems than Western population because of our different food habits and our lifestyle. So that, how did they find that? Because of epidemiology. Okay, and the epidemiology also identifies and determines geographic patterns, that is which area the disease spreads, why the disease spreads, does climate have a role to play, that does the contour of the land have a role to play, in hilly climate what diseases occur, whether it is more, whether it is less. So all these factors are studied by epidemiologists. Can you imagine there are hundreds and thousands of research topics that you can select just based on these uses of epidemiology? You can try to find why coronavirus is affecting certain people, why cancer is affecting certain people, who gets cured, who doesn't get cured, what is the extent of treatment that people are getting, whether the treatment is right. Everything comes under the purview of epidemiology. Okay, then the next is purpose of epidemiology. What is the purpose of epidemiology? Why do we need this subject? Epidemiology is forms a basis for developing disease control and prevention measures. So the main aim or purpose of epidemiology is, once you study the disease and pattern and who gets and who doesn't get, all that, then you will be able to control the disease and have measures to prevent the disease for even those who are at risk. Again, we'll go to the coronavirus example. Once the disease has been studied, who gets, how they get, then epidemiologists will plan and say, if you wear masks, if you do social distancing, then you can prevent the disease. That is the initial stage. Now they are saying asymptomatic people will not spread the disease. They will not need much treatment. So like that, we will be able to plan the disease control and prevention, especially for groups at risk, so that we will be able to completely eradicate the disease. There are two types of epidemiology. What are they? One is descriptive epidemiology. Descriptive is always in detail. Okay, so we are examining the distribution of disease in a population and observing all the features of its disease. That is, we are studying everything about the disease and where it spreads, how it spreads, all that in detail. Okay, descriptive. We are studying every area where it affects. Then analytical epidemiology, we analyze the data. Once we have studied the whole extent description, then we create a hypothesis. That in, that is, in our mind, we create a thinking that this is the cause of the disease and this is how it spreads. And then we analyze that, and that is analytical epidemiology. Okay. Next, we go to the epidemiological observations and diagnosis of disease. Okay. One important thing that you have to know as an epidemiologist is the epidemiological triangle. Okay, I could have drawn a triangle, but here, because it's an online class, I didn't draw here. But if you go to the internet and check, there is a triangle. One corner of the triangle is the host, other corner is the agent, another corner is the environment. So all three are dependent on each other to cause a disease. Any one is not there, then disease may not be caused. All three together, when they are available, then the chances of disease is high. So for example, who is a host? Host means the person in whom the disease occurs. Okay, it's the human being. So host is usually the human being. So in a human being, what are the things that cause the disease? Your personal traits, that is, whether you smoke, whether you drink, whether you are obese, whether you have hypertension, or all your whether you have genetic predisposition. So these are personal traits. And behavior, how you behave, whether you are taking your medicines properly, whether you are exercising properly, whether you do walking regularly. So that's your behavior. Genetic predisposition, whether you are your parents have passed on a disease to you, whether your parents had cardiac problem and you are also suffering because of that. And the immunological factors, each of our immunity levels differ. That's what, when coronavirus people say, the immunity levels are important in preventing the disease. So the immunological factors is very important. So these are the host factors. So these are all present in the human being. So if a human being has variations, then that will affect whether a person gets a disease or not. Then the second part of the triangle is the agent. Okay. Agent could be biological, physical, chemical, environmental, or psychological experiences. So biological, microorganism like virus, bacteria, fungi. So these are biological causes of disease. Agents are the causes of disease. Then physical. So temperature, radiation, trauma, other things. These can also cause disease. And they can be agents which affect the severity of disease. Okay, for example, people say coronavirus can stay alive for a long time in a colder climate than in a warm climate. So that is the physical aspect. Then the chemical aspect, that is acid, alkali, poison, tobacco, these can cause disease, and they can also affect the way in which a person's disease is spread. For example, if you wash your hands using soap, particular chemical, you can prevent coronavirus. Okay, so that is the effect on the agent. Then the environment, that is nutrients in your diet, whether allergy is there. Some people, if they go and smell a flower, then they will start sneezing because the pollen in the flower will cause them to get allergy. Some people, when they are exposed to dust, they will get sneezing. Some people, when they walk in the polluted environment, they'll get sneezing and they'll get breathing difficulty. So that is environment. Then psychological experiences. People have a lot of psychological diseases, and that's based on their experiences. Then the environmental factors, that is external conditions, like living conditions. You know, in tuberculosis, the living conditions are very important, and people living close together in crowded areas, they get disease. Then water supply. There are some diseases which are caused due to contaminated water, like typhoid. And then sewage. All these are living conditions. Then the atmosphere and climate, whether you live in a hilly area, whether you live in a polluted area, whether you live in a normal area. So all these are atmosphere and climate. Then the modes of communication. So the environment and the host and the agent is brought together through this method. Okay, so when the environment, for example, if a person in Chennai is having coronavirus, if you visit that person's house, that is, you are going to an environment where there is coronavirus. Then you shake hands with the person. That is your behavior. So the host factor comes into play. Because of your behavior, you are exposed to the virus risk. And then if you do not wash your hands, if you are using the same hand to rub your eyes or nose, then you get the disease. So this is how the host, agent and environment come together to cause a disease. There are three other factors that can affect whether you get the disease. That is the person, the place and the time. So the person, what are the factors that are involved? These are the determinants which you studied in the second year. Age, gender, ethnic group, genetic predisposition, whether you have a concurrent disease, like in coronavirus they say comorbidities, that is other health conditions. Then a person who has poor diet, health, physical activity, smoking, risk-taking behavior, all this, there are two sides to it. There is a positive side, negative side. Age, old age, young age, and a middle age. Gender, male, female, or a third gender. Ethnic group, whether you are Indian, American. So every factor comes into play when you get a disease, because some groups will not get a particular disease because of their all these factors. Some people will get the disease because of these factors. Then the geographical place, the place where you live, the climate that is in the place, the geology, the population density, the economic development of the place, the food habits in that area, medical practices that are available. For example, if you get coronavirus in North India in a remote part of the country, there will not be any treatment available. Whereas in Vellore, there are two medical colleges. Chennai, there are four or five medical colleges. So health practices is very high in places like Tamil Nadu. At the same time, food habits. If you are in a poor family, then your food habits, you will not have enough nutrients in your body. Whereas if you are from a rich, affluent family, then you will have a lot of good food that will improve your immunity. So all these factors play a role. And the study of these factors in whether a person is getting a disease or not is the role of the epidemiologist. Then the time. Time means the calendar time, that is the day, the time of the year, the seasons, whether it's a summer season, winter season, because some diseases occur in summer, some diseases occur in winter, some diseases occur in all climates. So all these factors, and the seasonality, the changes. So all these factors play a role in the disease. So if you relate all these information to the coronavirus, you will understand much better the above information and also the information which I am going to give you now. For example, the level of disease occurrence, you would have studied about endemic, pandemic and all that. So what is endemic, what is pandemic? It is based on the level of disease occurrence and where the disease occurs. Sporadic means one case here and there. That is, in Vellore, if there are three cases, that is sporadic. For example, if there is a new disease which has occurred and only three patients are there in Vellore, in the whole world, and one person is in Katpadi, one in Vellore, one in Bagayam, one in Satvachari, then we call it sporadic. That is, it's not close together, but in spread out in different parts of the place. If five people in the same street are having a disease, it's called a cluster. Okay. Coronavirus, we keep hearing clusters of people. That is, one person gets affected, they spread the disease to many people living in the same area. That is a cluster. Then endemic. Endemic means it is continuously present in a particular area in but a low level. That is, it is not very high numbers. For example, if you have malaria or dengue in a particular city, every year it will come. Like for example, in Vellore, every year when the rainy season comes, the mosquitoes will breed and they will cause malaria or dengue. But the number of people affected will be less than 100 or 500. It will not be 1,000, 50,000 like that. So that means it's endemic. It is present always in the same area, but it is controllable and to a moderate level. Hyperendemic means it is continuously present, but the number is very high. That is hyperendemic. Epidemic means it is more than what you expected and it spreads to many places within a particular geographic location. For example, in Tamil Nadu, if a particular disease spreads all over Tamil Nadu, but it is limited to Tamil Nadu, it has not gone to Kerala, it has not gone abroad, then you call it epidemic. It is just like the pandemic, but it is limited to one geographical area. Pandemic means it spreads across countries, spreads across continents, and affects a large number of people. So then it is called as a pandemic. So we are all either lucky or unlucky to live in an era where we have seen a pandemic. You know, the previous pandemic, as far as I remember, was a Spanish flu in 1920s. So after 100 years, a pandemic has affected the world. And the other diseases, other factors influencing disease transmission are agent environment. This we have already seen. Infectivity, pathogenicity, virulence. Okay, we have heard people talk about coronavirus telling it is very infectious, it is highly pathogenic, and it is virulent, that is, it is very strong and spreads from place to place. Then immunogenicity, that is, whether a person is having immunity or not. So all these factors, you relate to coronavirus, you'll understand it better. Then the survival, weather, housing, geography, we have discussed all this already. Then occupational setting, where you do an occupation. For example, a healthcare worker or a sanitary worker are at more risk of getting coronavirus than other people who stay at home. Then the air quality, food, host, age, sex, genes, behavior, nutritional status, health status, all these affect the disease transmission. Okay. Then measures of infectivity, pathogenicity, and mortality. That is, infectivity is ability to infect. Whether a particular disease can infect other people, whether it can spread. And the number of people who get infected, okay, out of those people who are susceptible. So this is infectivity. Pathogenicity is ability to cause the disease. This can be calculated by number of the clinical cases by number infected into 100. Okay, so infectivity is number infected by number susceptible into 100. Pathogenicity is number with the disease by number infected. Okay, so total number of people with the particular disease by total number of those infected. For example, in a class of 100 students, if the virus spreads among all 100, but only 10 people get the disease, but other people, because of their immunity, they do not get the disease, then you will calculate pathogenicity by number with clinical disease, that is 10, number infected will be 100 into 100, that is pathogenicity is 10%. That's how you calculate it. Then virulence or ability to cause seriousness in the disease or death is number of deaths by number with disease into 100. So we said in a class of 100, 10 people got a particular disease, of which if one person died, then the virulence of the disease is 1 by 10 into 100, that is 10%. Okay, so all these are dependent on the host factors. So based on the host, how you have immunity, what food you eat, what is your behavior, all these factors play a role in whether you are infectable, whether the disease can cause death in you or seriousness in the problems in you. So all these factors are important. So this is the measures of infectivity, pathogenicity, and mortality. This actually is part of your next topic also, which we'll see. That is epidemiological measures of disease. Okay, so epidemics occur when host, environment, and agent are not in balance. We already saw a disease can be caused by host, environment, and agent. So when these are not in balance, then it can lead to disease. Then when there is a new agent, like coronavirus, for example, it's a new agent. You did not know it 10 years back. So it's a new agent and it is changing. You know, Tamil Nadu, they say a new type of virus is found and there are 13 types of coronavirus. So each of this can have a particular amount of infectivity, pathogenicity and virulence. With the measurements or calculation we saw just now. So how that virus is infective or pathogenic or virulent, we will be able to calculate. Then epidemics also occur when there is a change in the number of susceptibility in the population. For example, when more people become when there are more people are being affected by a particular disease, then epidemics will occur. Then when the environment changes that cause the transmission, for example, if we had lived 100 to 500 years back, if the coronavirus had been there, what would have happened? There would be less people affected because there were no planes at that time and ships would have carried the virus very slowly. But now, because China had the virus first and within 2 months it spread all over the world because everybody were traveling abroad, people were going by planes, they got infected, they infected other people and the whole world got the disease. So an epidemic became a pandemic. In Wuhan it was an epidemic, and from Wuhan in China it became a pandemic to affect the whole world. So we have to measure each of these aspects of the disease so that we will be able to control the disease and prevent the disease. Okay, we are studying all this mainly to control the diseases and prevent diseases. Then we come to epidemiological activities. What are the activities? Means we study the relationship between exposure. For example, if you are exposed to a virus, then how it affects you, whether it causes a disease in you or whether it does not cause a disease. If it does not cause a disease, then you are a healthy control. That is, even after you are exposed, you are not affected by the disease. So the purpose of this is mainly to see the prevalence and incidence and the incidence density. So these are all studies of measuring who gets the disease. Okay. Then we see the distribution of disease in populations. So coronavirus, for example, it has affected all over the world. So we have to see which kind of people get the disease, who does not get the disease, who dies, who lives, who has serious illnesses, who does not have serious illnesses. So all this is based on the morbidity, mortality, incidence and prevalence. Okay, incidence and prevalence I've already explained, mortality and morbidity you all know. So let's go back to see what is the definition of prevalence again. Prevalence measures the proportion of individuals in a defined population that have a disease or other health outcomes of interest at a specific point of time. For example, today is that specific point of time. If we take today, how many people in Vellore have been exposed to the virus and how many have got the disease? That is prevalence. Okay, during a particular period of time, within the last 1 month, and at this present time, how many people have got the disease? That is prevalence. Prevalence is based on incidence rate and the duration of disease. Okay, so suppose 5 people have already got the disease and they are cured, we cannot calculate them for prevalence because they are not having the disease now, they have already been cured, so they will not come into the prevalence. Okay, so that is the calculation of prevalence, how many people are having a particular disease at a particular time. So if today, for example, if we calculate those who have cured already, we will not take them as prevalent disease. Okay, so the next thing is the incidence. Incidence is the measure of new cases of a disease that develops in a population at risk during a specified time period. For example, if we want to calculate the incidence of coronavirus in Vellore at the end of 2020, then from January to December, we will calculate all the people who had coronavirus and we'll say this is the incidence of the total population. That is, if we have 10,000 population, of which 1,000 people had coronavirus, we'll say 1,000 by 10,000, that is the incidence or number of people having coronavirus. Okay, there are two main measures of incidence. How can you measure incidence is based on the risk and the rate. Okay, so incidence, in any incidence of a disease, two factors play a role: the people who are at risk and the rate at which it spreads. So the population at risk is the whole population for coronavirus, but for road accidents, if you want to see the risk, who is at risk? Those who go to the road. An old lady sitting in home because she is bedridden, she will not be at risk of dying in a road accident. Okay, whereas for coronavirus, everybody is at risk almost, because it can spread very easily. Who is at risk of getting HIV? Those who are having blood transfusion, those who are having unsafe sexual practices, those who are drug addicts sharing needles, they are at risk. Okay, suppose you are a drug addict without sharing needles, you are only taking oral drugs, you will not be at risk of HIV. Suppose you have safe sexual practices, you will not be at risk of HIV. So you understand the risk. It's the population who are at risk. Then the rate. Rate means the number of people who get the disease. Okay, that is the rate. So how do we measure all these things? Through studies. Studies means research. So that is why research is very important for a medical sociologist, because when you do research, then you will be looking at all the diseases in the world. You will be able to identify the cause, the treatment, the who gets the disease, and that is a great benefit for the whole world. Okay, so what are the types of studies that you do, or the research that you do? They are cross-sectional research, clinical trials, cohort studies, case control studies, epidemiological measures of effect, differences in disease risk, ratios in disease risk, and relative differences in disease risk, of which we are going to study case control and cohort studies in detail. Okay, some of which some of these you studied in research in second year in detail, but now in this subject we are going to study cohort and case control in detail. Okay, so we'll see that in the next class.